FEMA, which stands for the Federal Emergency Management Agency, helps people before, during, and after disasters. There's several different programs within the agency, from mitigation to preparedness to response and recovery and grants, and several other program specialties in between. We at FEMA are not first responders, but we help with the coordination of resources. So we really try our best to connect people with the resources that are needed, and we support our state and tribal and community partners throughout this process. My role is the Community Preparedness Officer, so my team focuses on individual and community preparedness, meaning we work really closely with our state, tribal, and community partners within Region 10, Washington, Oregon, Idaho, and Alaska, on helping people get informed and motivated to get better prepared for anything that may come their way in terms of emergencies and disasters. We do this through a lot of creative and engaging outreach and educational events, which mostly have been webinars and virtual events over the last year and a half.
My role within FEMA is the Region 10 Disability Integration Specialist. And really the role of a disability integration specialist is to maximize the inclusion of people with disabilities in everything that FEMA does. We work a lot with our state, local, tribal, territory partners. We provide tools, resources, strategies to include people with disabilities. And ultimately, we want individuals with disabilities, older adults, to participate, be at the planning table, and ultimately benefit from the programs and services that emergency managers, providers are offering. So the partnerships that FEMA has to support older adults, people with disabilities, a lot of this is a lot of the tremendous effort that our states have done to develop what we refer to as disability advisory groups, disability stakeholders to advise emergency management. These groups are made up of cross-disability, older adults, agencies, organizations that represent blind, deaf, hard of hearing, mobility, cognitive, intellectual, mental health, that represent the whole cross-sector of disability. And ultimately, these entities provide services, community-based supports. They address academia, research, self-advocates. And some of these groups include area agencies on aging, Aging Disability Resource Center, Centers for Independent Living, State Independent Living Council, disability rights, self-advocates, Commission for the Blind, long-term care ombudsmans, and representatives from long-term care and in-home care supports, caregiver alliances. So really, these are state groups, and ultimately, they're an opportunity for emergency managers, for people with disabilities to identify resources, get information, share information, and ultimately bridge that gap, understanding of what disability agencies, older adult agencies and organizations do, and how they can contribute to emergency management, and how emergency management can continue to help to support the needs of individuals during a disaster. One prominent group within Oregon is the Oregon Disability Emergency Management Advisory Council. So this is a group that's co-sponsored by Oregon Health Authority, by the Oregon Department of Human Services, by Oregon Emergency Management. So that it's a great outlet for agencies, organizations, whether community-based, social service, self-advocates, to get involved. They're in contact with emergency management, and they're continually developing plans for individual, agency, organizational preparedness, and how to respond and recover in disasters.
And I'm going to keep asking you for a little bit, and maybe Alyssa, if you want to answer, you'll have to tell me. But I would love to know, like, you know, this disability integration is such an important part of, you know, and so aligned with what we're trying to do, make sure that, you know, older adults and people with disabilities are not left behind when there's a disaster. So can you talk about, you know, what does that look like? You know, what does integration look like? What does it mean? You know, because I found out that there's only one real disaster registry here in Oregon. And, you know, What does that look like? Can you talk about that? Like, what is the situation? Like, are we going to, people are so afraid. What can people do? How can they get help if they are concerned? Like, let's say they have some mobility challenges, or they are hard of hearing, or, you know, what does it, like, how will people be able to benefit from the kind of integration work that you're trying to get done? Does that make any sense? I'm going to leave. So think about it for a minute and just like, what might it look like?
Ultimately, what we want is we want to have people with disabilities, older adults, self-advocates, those agencies and organizations that represent and serve that population. We want them present at the planning table. Working through the state advisory groups is a great opportunity to do that. There's opportunities to participate or integrate into mass care planning. So that could be something where an individual shows up at a shelter. Maybe they do need some type of extra personal care support. Maybe they did not evacuate with their mobility device. They need a sign language interpreter or they're hard of hearing. So it's really, you have to have that perspective, a person with a lived experience who can share what those needs may be. So they can definitely inform the process for emergency planners, for mass care planners, for any aspect of emergency management. And that's why it's so important that we plan with the population versus plan for the population, because we need that lived experience to better inform what those needs may be in a disaster. I think one of the biggest things that we have learned and what I have learned in my role as disability integration is what we know is that an active community is a resilient community. And so active, those social service agencies, organizations, people with disabilities, older adults, they know their communities the best. I think what we've learned at the federal level and even at times at the state level is that we need to do a better job of connecting with those agencies and organizations. This is typically outside of our federal partners. We need to expand that circle to look at the partners who look at housing, medical, transportation, financial, access to services and resources. What are those older adult disability agencies and organizations that have that expertise? And are we looping those type of social service entities, agencies, organizations early on in the conversation? Or are we waiting until the disaster happens? I think we can benefit a lot in our planning and knowledge that those folks have a role in response, because they very much do have a role in response in identifying accessible housing. If somebody lost some type of durable medical equipment, a walker, a wheelchair, they may need something temporary and kind of that long-term recovery. Transportation is always a huge issue. People either lose vehicles, didn't drive in the first place, or maybe they were dependent on public transportation and now those resources don't exist. So who has accessible wheelchair, accessible transportation? So those are the types of services that we need to think about up front, and who has that expertise at the community level. And we need to start to integrate those conversations early on in those agencies, organizations into our planning.
Individual preparedness is very important because, as many of us know, disasters and emergencies start and end locally. And so in a large disaster or a catastrophic event, it's going to be some time until the first responders are able to arrive and help people. And so that's why it's critical that we are as self-reliant and community-reliant as possible so that we could help ourselves and help each other, because we don't know how long it's going to take until the first responders are able to get to the scene. I mean, it can be daunting, I understand, but it really doesn't need to be. I like to break it down into just a few steps. First one is being informed, knowing what risks and hazards and threats are in your community, whether those are potential natural hazards like wildfires, flooding, earthquakes, which I know all of those definitely are hazards within Oregon and the Pacific Northwest at large. And then once you know what the hazards are, how do you stay connected and informed of alerts? And if you need to take any action to make sure you and your loved ones are safe. So that's why signing up for your local alerts is crucial. So if you aren't already signed up for your local alerts, just with a quick Google search or phone your local emergency management office, ask how to do that and you should be good to go. And then you can be notified of any actions you need to take, whether that's evacuation, sheltering in place, and so forth. Once you are informed and signed up for alerts, you should also make sure to have some sort of an emergency plan for yourself, your household, and your loved ones. What that means is think things through. How are you going to communicate and get a hold of your loved ones if you're not together when something catastrophic happens, like an earthquake? If the phone lines aren't working, how can you get a hold of each other? Or maybe you're able to send a text versus a phone call. Maybe you're able to get connected through your out-of-state contact if you can't make a local phone call, because long-distance lines may work, whereas local phone lines can be tied up after an event. Also, knowing where your meeting place is, if you need assistance to get there or if you need assistance evacuating, having those plans in place and being in communication with your support network on that. Aside from having an emergency plan / communication plan, it's important to have supplies set aside, to have all those essential items for up to 2 weeks, ideally, but just start small. One day is a good starting point with the goal of 2 weeks. Oregon does recommend being 2 weeks ready because of that catastrophic Cascadia subduction zone earthquake. That might include shelter in place items that you keep at home, because it's very unrealistic to be able to carry all of your 2 weeks worth of supplies with you if you have to leave, but it's good to have somewhere in your house. It's also important to have a go bag, especially for people who are at risk of wildfires, but it's important to have one regardless, because a house fire could happen, or it can be useful for day-to-day emergencies. And that basically means a backpack or a suitcase on wheels, something that you could easily take at a moment's notice that has all of your essential items consolidated, so that you don't have to start looking around for things when you're already stressed because of some sort of emergency or disaster. And the last item I encourage you to do is to get involved and connect with your community and share your knowledge and your motivation and interest in getting prepared with other people. So that might be getting trained in first aid and CPR, going through CERT, the Community Emergency Response Team training. It could be volunteering at your local food bank. Whatever it is, many of you are already connected to your community, and we encourage you to keep those connections strong, because it really comes down to you and your community before and after a disaster. So just to recap, being informed, signing up for your local alerts, making an emergency plan, including how you'll communicate with your loved ones, getting a kit and getting all those essential supplies ready to go, both for shelter at place and as a to-go bag wherever you spend a lot of time, either in your house, in your car, at a community center. And last thing is getting involved and staying connected with your community. So our FEMA Region 10 Individual and Community Preparedness Team is currently focused on doing more outreach, engagement, and education tailored for older adults. So we're really excited about this opportunity to support AARP Oregon with this event, and we look forward to future conversations. We actually just hosted a webinar earlier today for older adults focused on preparedness at home. And we had advocates, individuals, and different organizations represented from Oregon, Washington, Idaho, and Alaska on that. And we have another webinar coming up this Thursday. All of these webinars are recorded. So by the time you're seeing this video, I realize it's in the past, but you can watch the recordings and we'll be sharing that link shortly. Aside from our efforts there, we just really want you to get involved in your community and reach out to your state and local emergency management office or disability advisory group or whatever sort of niche or group you are interested in that contributes to community resilience. And of course, ready.gov is kind of the encyclopedia of all things preparedness. So if you have a chance, check out ready.gov. It has some tips and tricks of how to put together an emergency plan and what to include in your supplies, your supply kit. And at the Region 10 level, we do have a individual and community preparedness dashboard, which has a plethora of resources. So we'll be sharing that link as well, and we encourage you to check it out.